UFC 256 sees the two best flyweights in the world go head-to-head as the reigning king Davison Figueiredo puts his belt on the line against the number one contender Brandon Moreno. Having carved through the division's elite with his powerful striking and finishing ability, Brazil's Davison Figueiredo delivered a near flawless performance at UFC 255.
Davison Figueiredo successfully retains the flyweight title.
Now just 3 weeks after his first title defense, the God of War returns to the octagon, looking to round out the year with a fourth straight victory. Opportunities don't come much bigger than this for Mexico's Brandon Moreno. After an impressive victory of his own at UFC 255.
And Brandon Moreno, what a performance!
The assassin baby not only gets his shot at the 125-pound belt, but the chance to prove he is the best flyweight in the world. Will Moreno seize the gold in Vegas at UFC 256? Or will the God of War triumph once again on MMA's toughest battleground?
Hello and welcome to UFC Inside the Octagon. John Gooden alongside Dan Hardy for the final pay-per-view of 2020, UFC 256. And Dan, a massive opportunity has been presented to Brandon Moreno, who interestingly featured on the very same card as Davison Figueiredo just 21 days ago. This will be the fastest championship turnaround in UFC history for the current champ, Figueiredo. This is a great fight. Very much looking forward to it. Top line, what's your take?
Well, you know, it's a great opportunity, as you said, and that's really what 2020 has been about. You know, it's been a strange year, but as far as a fighter goes, you know, if you're ready and you're happy to take short notice fights, you know, you can make a big name for yourself this year, as we've seen with, you know, the likes of Khamzat Chimaev, etc. The difference here is that this is Davison Figueiredo, who's the champion, who's stepping in again, you know, on short notice, new opponent. I mean, the last time out, he was supposed to be facing Cody Garbrandt. He ended up with Alex Perez. Now he's out there again with another challenging opponent with no full training camp to really fully prepare for them. You know, it just shows the confidence of Davison Figueiredo. It shows the belief in his own capabilities, what he feels like he can do in this division, and, you know, how tenacious he is at getting through these challenges. It speaks to me like he's planning on going for a second belt at some point, but we'll save that for the future.
Well, let's get into the facts and the stats, shall we? And this is familiar. The last time we were sat here doing Inside the Octagon, we saw this very man, Davison Figueiredo. He won that championship belt on Fight Island on the 19th of July. He made that first defense, as I was just mentioning, just a little while back on the 21st of November. They go again on the 12th. And physically, Dan, there's a little bit between these two. It's 2-inch reach for Brandon Moreno. Are we looking at that closely or not too much?
Well, you know, I mean, Brandon Moreno will be wanting to utilize that reach advantage. The challenge here, though, is, you know, it doesn't matter how long your reach advantage is. If you can't keep your opponent away from you, it kind of nullifies that advantage. And this is what he's up against here with Figueiredo. You know, Figueiredo is not too worried about those extra couple of inches because he's going to be standing so close to him that he can hit him with his own arms without worrying too much about what's coming back. I mean, that's really the story of Figueiredo. You know, he's confident in his boxing exchanges. He knows he's got the power to make a difference in this division, no matter who he's trading punches with. And, you know, Moreno has got to maintain the space between them to make that reach an advantage for him. Otherwise, he's just going to find himself compressed up against the fence, dealing with the same power that everybody else in the division is well aware is a danger to them.
Interesting stuff. I think you'll agree, Dan, it's nightmare viewing when you look at the stats board. For any one of Figueiredo's opponents, he's just got that fight finishing ability. But what we really need to see is the analysis. They're just the numbers. I'm sure you're going to show us a lot more gold here. And I think we'll turn straight to the challenger, shall we? A guy that we haven't broken down here on Inside the Octagon before. And as you were just saying, Dan, second stint with the UFC. First time around, made his debut when he was 22. I think at that time he was in amongst the top 10 youngest fighters on the roster. We saw him on The Ultimate Fighter as well, getting some really good experience against some really, really tough guys at the same time. But it's since he came back to the UFC, 3-fight win streak, he's shown evolution in all aspects of his game. But I've really liked what I've seen with his striking.
I agree. And I think we've seen a big improvement in his second stint in the UFC. You know, those early fights that he had, the Ryan Benoit fight, the Dustin Ortiz fight in particular, you know, he's very much lead hand dominant. You know, lead uppercuts, lead hooks, hooks to the body. You know, he's got a good lead body kick and a good head kick that he caught Dustin Ortiz with as well. But, you know, we saw him struggle a little bit at times in the striking ranges, especially against Sergio Pettis. He always looked like he was a couple of steps behind Pettis. Whereas when he faced Kai Kara France, I honestly expected him to have similar kind of problems. And his striking just looked entirely different to me. You know, he managed range well. He established an excellent jab, which was very, very confident, very casual. You know, he's leaning heavy on his lead leg. He's using his face as bait, as we've seen, you know, the likes of Israel Adesanya do. Like, he wants you to trade with him. He's quite happy to trade. I don't know if that's necessarily a good idea in this fight against Figueiredo, but there are certain, you know, the step up in confidence in his striking is going to be key, because he's going to need some confidence if Figueiredo is throwing rocks at him. But at the same time, establishing that jab in range, utilizing those extra couple of inches in reach, will allow him to then set up the other things from his, you know, from his long range striking game. You know, nice jab, couple that with the left hook, add some body and some head kicks in there. And I think that's a good skill set for him to at least hold Figueiredo off for the time being until the fight develops a bit. The one consistency I have seen in his game, aside from him being, you know, dominant with his lead hand, is that he tends to circle towards his left. So what often happens in his fights is he comes out, he'll touch gloves or he'll meet them in the center, and then he goes straight over to the right-hand panel and then circles left back through his corner. Now, moving clockwise around the octagon, it just seems to be a natural preference for him. The downside, though, is that he's moving towards the power punch of Figueiredo. Now, I would argue that both fists of Figueiredo are pretty powerful, but the knockout that we saw over Joe Benavidez in the first one was specifically Benavidez circling along the fence to Benavidez's left and getting caught with that right hand down the pipe. So Moreno's got to be very cautious about how quickly he's compressed up against the fence, because, you know, that's the thing with the punching power of Figueiredo. He doesn't even need to throw in order to get you to step backwards. You need the threat of a punch coming in your direction and people give him space. So what we're going to see is Moreno probably skirting along the fence and eventually getting squeezed up against it. And that's where Figueiredo comes with the big hands.
Okay. All right. Well, that leads us on then. We're not going to go much further without talking about the power of Figueiredo. His application for it, Dan, is the highest level, which is obviously why he's wearing that belt. So in isolation, the power punch of Figueiredo, you know, what do you like about it?
I like the fact that, I mean, not only does he believe in his punching power, which is evident, but he also is very educated in the way he delivers it. You know, there's another difference in the striking styles with these two guys. You know, if you watch Moreno's fights, he tends to kind of throw whatever comes to his mind. You know, in the Kai Kara France fight, we saw him establish a good jab, but everything that came off that was very much in the moment, the opportunity that he saw when it was there, and he would throw 3-4 punch combination and you know, something would maybe land. It's as confident, I would say, in the striking range, but it's not quite as educated as Figueiredo. Like, Figueiredo knows he only needs one punch, so he doesn't throw a whole barrage at people generally. He likes to pick his shots. He likes to make them count. So the volume is definitely on Moreno's side, so keeping him at distance with volume is ideal for him, whereas Figueiredo, he's going to walk into range with his hands at his waist. You know, I always talk about these guys, the Cub Swanson guys. They hang their hands at their waist. They're like gunfighters ready to pull a pistol out of a holster. But, like, he uses his head movement to slip out of the way, and he hits people with power punches, you know, in the best opportunities that he can find. And there's a real educated approach to that with Figueiredo. He knows not only where to deliver those punches, but how to force people up against the fence. When he goes through the punching range, the elbow game is something that's really dangerous of his as well. And that's something that it doesn't always get the fights finished, but it can also be the start of a finish. You know, the Marco Beltran fight, hit him with a couple of really nice elbows before he dropped him with the uppercut. And I just feel like the dynamic of this fight is going to end up with Moreno skirting along the fence with Figueiredo pressuring him up against the fence and throwing some heavy hands, but then crashing in with elbows behind it. And you know, this is the point where we get to see where, you know, what do people want to do with Figueiredo's striking power? Usually they just want to get out of the way of it. And that was the story in the last fight, which I know we're going to get into after the break.
What do you think about the fight IQ between these two fighters? Moreno's young, but he's got a lot of experience. But do you think he's got the same level of fighting nous that we see from the champion?
I think he's got a different skill set. So it educates his fight IQ in a different way. I think Figueiredo knows that he's got finishing capacity in every range of the fight. And he reads his opportunities in the fight. You know, it's much less about... If you watch the two guys fight, there's much less of an internal process going on with Figueiredo. His focus is so much more external. It's so much more where his opponent is, how are they moving, where are they putting their hands when they're throwing their punches, etc., etc. How do I land one of these big, powerful shots?
More
with
reactive,
Moreno,
you would say.
Exactly. But reactive in an educated way. Whereas Moreno, it's much more, you know, oh, I'll throw this combination. I'll go right hand, hook, uppercut. And there's a bit more of a recklessness to his style, which he's not necessarily picking his shots quite as well. And like I said, in the Kaikara France fight, we did see a step up in his improvement. You know, we did see that jab really start to open up the rest of his game. But I don't think he's got the striking power to really start picking those shots like Figueiredo has.
Okay, thank you, Dan. We're going to have to take a break right now. We're only just scratching the surface here on Inside the Octagon for this main event at UFC 256. So we will be back with the rest after the break. Welcome back to UFC Inside the Octagon, where we're spotlighting the main event for UFC 256, which is for the 125-pound UFC flyweight title between the champion Deiveson Figueiredo and Brandon Moreno. So in part one, what Dan, you were telling us was the increasingly improving Brandon Moreno is looking great with his striking inside the octagon, does a lot of work off of that lead hand, does move laterally and possibly into Deiveson Figueiredo's power punching, which we've seen evidence many times over. And that goes through that long range. But of course, when that gets shorter as well, he does have those elbows. Now, Dan, when fighters typically are presented with these opportunities against such a big punching fighter, it's either angle off, find a way out from the fence, or shoot in. Now, unfortunately for Alex Perez, he thought that he could shoot in at UFC 255, and he discovered that Figueiredo does indeed have a very decent way of finishing the fight from there as well.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the Alex Perez fight, you know, in a capsule was the perfect performance from Figueiredo to really paint what he's capable of. You know, like he walks people down with confidence in his striking power. Like in the Alex Perez fight, he was throwing powerful body kicks to Perez, which you could really see he didn't want to be on the end of. He didn't really want to be dealing with them. And then as soon as Figueiredo threw a big power right, Perez level changed underneath it. But if you watch the sequence of how this plays out, so Perez is in on a single leg, but he puts his head on the chest of Figueiredo. He puts himself in a very safe position, knowing how good the neck attacks of Figueiredo are. Runs him to the fence, and then he tabletops his leg. And part of the reason for doing that is so he's not level changing to put his head in a position where it can be attacked. Like, he's solving problems at the same time as working his wrestling offense, but Figueiredo was still able to figure it out. You know, as the leg was on Perez's shoulder and he's trying to trip that the base foot of Figueiredo, Deiveson jumped into a heel hook attempt, which then allowed him to roll through. For a brief moment, Alex Perez was on his back, but Figueiredo never stopped moving. He continually rolled through. The arm went over the back of Alex Perez's head, and the guillotine was there. And Alex Perez, even in that moment, knowing full well that he was in danger, he just couldn't get clear of the guard quick enough to get his neck safe. And that's the thing with Figueiredo's game is, you know, you've got to choose the you know, which poison. You know, do you want to deal with his striking power, or do you want to level change into his best submission asset, which is his guillotine? Mm. It's a difficult question to ask. And obviously, you know, with Moreno, you know, I feel like his striking game is going to be limited quite quickly because I feel like Figueiredo is going to feel he can walk him down and pressure him into the fence. So where we get the big power punches and the elbows. So I do see Moreno level changing at some point, whether it's to get the fight to the floor because he feels like that's his stronger suit in this fight, or whether it's just to get out of the way of those pointy elbows and power punches that are coming in his direction.
Yeah, and I think from my research, Brandon Moreno is very good at those entries as well, Dan. It seems to be great on the counter to some of these strikes. And when he grips a hold of his opponents, he's like Velcro, really, really tight takedowns. But Have you seen what perhaps Alex Perez didn't? Have you seen that he can protect his neck if indeed it goes that way and avoid that threat of the choke from Figueiredo?
I absolutely have. You know, and I was quite relieved to see this when I was researching Moreno's game as well, because, you know, I know he's a reckless individual. I know he loves to get scrappy and he loves to fight and be in the present moment. And sometimes when you're in the present moment and you're not thinking of each eventuality, you can do something that leaves yourself vulnerable. And I do think that the striking game is going to be a very risky game for him to play. There are certain things that work out well for him. But if he can level change into a safe takedown and force Perez to, Figueiredo to keep this, you know, MMA, then I feel like that's where Moreno can have an impact in this fight. You know, you look at the Benoit fight, you look at the last round in the Pettis fight, and against Formiga as well. You know, as he's level changing, he comes high on the hips, he wraps the legs up, but he's driving his head up at the same time. So he's putting the back of his head on the back of his opponent's shoulder, making it very difficult for him to break his posture and force him into a guillotine. So I feel like not only the speed at which he is able to transition into the wrestling exchanges, but also his awareness of keeping his head safe when he's in them, not only gets him out of the dangers of Figueiredo's game, you know, when he's level changing, but also allows him to work to his strong suit as well, which, you know, really is his back taking. You know, if you look at the ground games of these two guys, on one side you've got Figueiredo, who's, you know, he's had a recent win with rear naked choke over Benavidez. So we know he's got a good rear naked choke in his game, but of 8 submissions, he's got 5 guillotines. So Figueiredo's a striker with guillotines in my mind. It's to make it quite simple, that's how I've got to view him. On the flip side, I've got Moreno, who's a bit of a wild puncher, who's got a good entry, but also circles to people's backs very well. And then you look at his record, he's got 10 submissions, 5 of them are rear naked chokes. So 50% of the time, Moreno is able to get to the back and sink the hooks in and finish people with a rear naked choke. And I feel like that's the facet of his game that's going to be most interesting in this fight, is when they do clinch, can he keep his neck safe and get behind Figueiredo to start threatening his neck? Those scrambles are going to be wild. They're going to be tenacious. And I think that's going to be one of the most exciting points of the fight. But at the same time, the benefit is if the fight does end up back on the feet, I feel like fatigue might start to set in with Figueiredo. You know, even in some of his fights where, you know, he's been 2 minutes into the fight, he's had a couple of trades with his hands, you kind of see him taking some deep breaths. And I feel like Moreno being able to push the pace in this one a little bit might be able to, you know, show some cracks in the armor of Davison Figueiredo. And I really feel like, you know, the safest way to go is, do I deal with his striking or his grappling? I don't know. Let me make him tired first and see which one starts to fall off quicker.
Do you think that the back-to-back camps favours one fighter over the other? I guess my 2 pence worth on this one will be the fact that Moreno was the guy that didn't get the opportunity at 255 and therefore gets to, one, steal a bit more thunder from an increasingly dominant champion, if you like, if he makes his second, or he's made a title defence now. So he's, what I'm saying is, Figueiredo's growing in stature, so he steals some of that thunder. But at the same time, he got to see a couple of mistakes that the opponents have made, that Alex Perez made against Figueiredo. Does that benefit him? Or on the other side, Dan, is there something I'm missing maybe with the conditioning and the preparation that Figueiredo might need to make that championship weight?
You know, I think there are a lot of factors to it. I think it suits Figueiredo, the fact that he's, you know, he has to stay disciplined for a few more weeks to stay on championship weight and step in there and defend his belt again. I think that suits him, because I think the longer time between fights for Figueiredo, the more of a challenge it is for him to stay at the flyweight, to stay in the flyweight division.
Is that because he wrestles with water buffaloes in between camps and he just gets a little bit too chunky?
Dude, it might be, but I mean, you need some muscle mass to wrestle with water buffaloes, and that's the thing that you've got to notice with Figueiredo. I mean, he's a lean, muscular individual that is very much at the top end of this weight class. I feel like this is working out perfectly for him, because it'll get us, you know, potentially a second defense on his belt and open up opportunities for him to step up in the weight class. I wouldn't be surprised if we see him move up to bantamweight and try for a second belt at some point. But the benefit in keeping these fights close together, certainly for Figueiredo's weight cut, is going to be a benefit. And then, on the flip side, with Moreno, you know, getting overlooked at the last fight and Alex Perez getting the opportunity in front of him, I mean, how do you interpret that if you're Moreno? Do you see that as a vote of no confidence from the UFC that they didn't put you in as a contender? Do you see it as an opportunity to see the champion defend his belt against one more guy who's got similar skill sets to Moreno that, you know, you could potentially learn something from? Honestly, what we learned from that is that Figueiredo's guillotine's devastating no matter whether you think he's going to catch you with it or not, because Perez knew full well what was happening in that fight. He didn't want to deal with the striking. That was a conscious decision that he made to level change and get the fight to the floor. But you can see the approach. You know, he put his head in a safe place. You know, he was trying to tabletop the leg instead of level change to a double or a single, keeping his neck safe. You know, the processes were there to keep him in that fight. It just didn't work out for him. So, you know, Moreno's had the opportunity to see that tried and failed. It may change his game plan entirely. Moreno might decide that he just doesn't want to level change at all and he'll take the risk of getting knocked out. You know, and that might be educated purely from the Alex Perez fight. We just don't know. But, you know, what can be learned from Figueiredo from that fight? He did exactly what we expected him to do if he was going to win. He looked just as good as we expected him to look. So if anything, it's reassured Figueiredo and it's reestablished him as the dominant champion in the division. So that, if anything, puts questions in Moreno's mind.
You've mentioned dominant champion. Last one from me, Dan. Do you think a win over Moreno and an impressive win, if he's able to get it, really does open up a massive gulf between the champion and everyone else in a division that, for my liking, is super competitive in that top 10? I think most, and sometimes have, each beaten one another on any given night.
Yeah, you know, we've seen a lot of that. You know, we've seen a lot of fighters, they'll beat someone, they'll lose to somebody else. You know, it was the same with Perez. You know, he's got wins over guys that have beaten Formiga and vice versa. It's one of those kind of divisions where, because the fights move so fast and everybody in the division's well-rounded, the fights can really end in any kind of way at any given time. What Figueiredo is bringing to the division is a level of consistency, I feel. Now, both of these guys, their losses have all been decisions. Neither of these guys have been stopped. But what we're seeing with Figueiredo, not only holding the belt, but also now starting to take all of these, you know, these statistics and the most knockdowns, you know, he's a devastating individual. And I think that's the kind of prowess that you need in the flyweight division to hold it down. It's going to be someone that's chaotic like Moreno or like Perez or somebody like that that's going to really be able to push Figueiredo. But I just feel like at this point in time, you know, we're coming towards the end of 2020. Figueiredo at the moment, especially if he gets another title defense, he's probably looking like fighter of the year. It's been a perfect year for him. It's the perfect year to set him up for moving up a weight class next year or maybe inviting someone down to his division. I mean, you know, we were going to get Cody Garbrandt coming down, but honestly, I'd much rather see Figueiredo move up. I could see him being the champ. I can see him calling back Henry Cejudo if he gets a win here. You know, there's lots of opportunities for Figueiredo, and he's determined in his approach and he's confident, which is why he's taking these fights at short notice. Like, honestly, if I'm Figueiredo, I'm looking down this division and I'm thinking I'll fight every one of these guys one weekend after the next because I fancy my chances in every range. The longer this goes, the longer he sits at the top, the more he battles against the scales and the weight, the more chance there is of someone like a Brandon Moreno stepping in there and stealing the show. So I think it's smart for Figueiredo to get this turned around quickly and get back in there, because I think next year looks very much like a bantamweight year for Figueiredo.
Ooh, what a way that we end it, Dan. Might be a bantamweight year for Figueiredo in 2021. We shall see. He's got to get past Moreno first, of course. Mr. Hardy, thank you ever so much. That is it for this, the last pay-per-view of the year, the last Inside the Octagon for any pay-per-view as well. Thank you ever so much for watching. Enjoy the fights. If we don't see you before, happy holidays. Enjoy the festivities. We'll be back next year. See you then.